Always trust your talk.
We ask the questions.
What is needed in the world?
Grčki ekonomista i političar. Služio je kao ministar financija u ljevičarskoj vladi grčkog premijera Aleksisa Ciprasa. Zahvaljujući žestokoj kritici ekonomske politike Europske unije i odbacivanjem politike rezova, postao je jedan od najpoznatijih svjetskih ekonomista. O ratu u Ukrajini i zbog čega smatra da Ukrajinci nemaju šanse za pobjedu, sankcijama ruskim oligarsima i Londonu kao offshore oazi, za Al Jazeera govori Yannis Varoufakis.
So Mr. Varoufakis, hello and welcome to Al Jazeera, and thank you so much for taking the time to speak to us. Now, let's start with Ukraine. Are you surprised by the amount of EU and NATO solidarity with a non-member state? And do you see the arming of Ukraine with lethal military aid as opening the floodgates to a wider European conflict?
No and no. No, I'm not surprised, because the European Union lacks any coherence. So once the United States and NATO take the lead, the European Union follows, even if there are great doubts amongst European leaders of the wisdom of the strategy pursued. Regarding the wider European conflict, I think it is important to nip this in the bud, to take this out of the discussion. I don't believe there is any chance of any greater European conflict. The probability of that is next to zero. I do not believe that Putin will dare attack outside the Ukraine. I do not believe that NATO is foolish enough to generalize this conflict. The question concerns the people of the Ukraine, whether we in the West and the whole world manages to exert sufficient pressure on all sides to end the conflict, to end the killings, to end the maimings, for the benefits of the Ukrainians, of the Russians, of Europeans, of the whole world. That is the number one issue at the moment.
Now, if you could compare the West's reaction towards Russia's invasion of Ukraine with their reactions or the lack thereof towards America's invasion of Iraq in 2003, what would the key differences be in terms of global response? I mean, I remember back in 2003, prominent left-wingers supporting the war against Iraq.
Very few, prominent, but very few. People like, you know, people that I used to admire, like Christopher Hitchens.
Right.
But not that many. Let me remind you that before the invasion of Iraq by George W. Bush, Tony Blair, and so on, there were millions of Europeans in the streets of London, of Paris, of Athens, of Rome, demonstrating against the war. So let's not forget that. The fact that the peoples of Europe were completely ignored by the leaders of Europe is a separate matter. And here we have a case of gross hypocrisy on behalf of the elites, of the ruling classes of the West. Respect for international law only applies to people like Putin. It doesn't apply to them. They can violate the United Nations Charter whenever they feel like it. They can lead to the death of 1 million Iraqis and still think that they were morally superior in some way, and then scream blue murder when somebody like Putin, who is an abominable character, I have no doubt about that, emulates them, even though the emulation is, you know, tragic as it is and criminal as it is only a small percentage of the crimes by the West in places like Iran and Afghanistan.
Right.
Iraq and Afghanistan.
But do you think there was a lot of warmongering among Western elites now when Russia began its invasion of Ukraine?
Absolutely, but it makes not one iota of surprise in my head, because let's face it, there's a lot of money involved. Let me give you an example. We hear our leaders on our media celebrate the fact that European countries, America, are putting their resources together in order to invest in, let's say, you know, supersonic nuclear weapons. What's the logic in this? There is no logic to this, because even if we had those supersonic nuclear weapons, what were we going to do? Bomb Moscow? Of course not. there are enough nuclear weapons on this planet to destroy the Earth many times over. But let's not forget, and this was a point I was trying to make, that supersonic nuclear weapons are an immense bonanza for the manufacturers and for the middlemen and for the lobbyists. So let me be clear on this. There's no conspiracy here. Putin chose this war. It was a criminal choice by Vladimir Putin. But once he had made that choice, many in the West saw this as a fantastic opportunity in order to, you know, to start spending money on things that are completely unnecessary in the persecution of the war or the persecution of the peace, but which make some people who are already very rich incredibly richer.
Mm-hmm. Now, why do you argue that the West is, quote unquote, playing with fire if it pushes for regime change in nuclear-armed Russia? And do you think President Joe Biden's comments that Putin must go were irresponsible, perhaps even reckless?
Look, if I say that Putin must, I have every right to say that, because my comrades in Russia, Democrats in Russia, are suffering under Putin. But they, the Russian Democrats, are the only people who have the capacity, at least in theory, and the moral right and obligation to remove Putin. Joe Biden does not. He has neither the capacity nor the moral obligation. When he says that Putin must be dragged through the courts, I would like to see Putin being tried, but by Russians, by Russian Democrats, not by Mr. Biden, who should also be in some kind of international court, because let's not forget, he supported the bombing of Yugoslavia. He supported the invasion of Iraq. You know, he was part of an administration that destroyed Libya in the name of democracy. We've seen the democracy that Libya has today. So to conclude, when Biden says that Putin should be dragged to the courts, effectively he's signaling that the United States are not going to help bring a swift end to the conflict in Ukraine. They are sacrificing the Ukrainians. The only rational, reasonable, legitimate thing for the United States president to do today is to have a summit meeting with Vladimir Putin, whatever he may think of him, to shake hands so that there is a ceasefire immediately, there is a withdrawal of Russian troops from the Ukraine, and there is a solution that everybody will be dissatisfied with, but which will bring peace to the Ukraine. It will secure sovereignty of the Ukraine, a neutrality solution like Finland or Austria had under the Cold War. That is what is in the interest of the world, of the Ukrainians. That's what the American president should be doing. When he talks about putting Putin through an international court, effectively, Joe Biden is declaring himself unfit to be the leader of a democratic state that is pursuing peace.
Now, when you talk about neutrality, I came across an earlier article of yours where you argue that neutrality of Eastern Europe is not a second but a first best option in order to minimize tensions with Russia. So do you still think it was a mistake for NATO to include former Eastern Bloc states into NATO?
Absolutely. Look,
why?
I'm going to take this a little bit further.
Sure.
Putin is in power today because the West chose to use the opportunity that was given to it by the collapse of the Soviet Union to humiliate and to impoverish Russia. Let me remind you that in 1991, when the Soviet Union came tumbling down, we had a government in Russia that were pro-reform, pro-Western, pro-capitalist, not people that I agreed with, but they were liberals and neoliberals who wanted effectively Russia to become part of the West. And what did the United States government do between 1991 and 1998? It destroyed them. It used the International Monetary Fund to bankrupt what was left of Russia, to drive the vast majority of Russians into extreme poverty, to reduce the expected life duration of males in Russia by 15, 20 years. This is just amazing.
Yeah, from 75 to 58 years.
Unbelievable, right? And, you know, by 1998, the good name of Western democracy had been destroyed by the West in Russia, and a KGB colonel, whose name we all know as Vladimir Putin, rose up in this humiliated Russia and offered them a Faustian bargain. I'm going to make you strong again. I'm going to end the Russia's humiliation. You are going to make me a czar. And that's what we have. Putin, in a sense, the monster that we have here today in our midst, is a creation of the West. It's a creation of the West's condescending and toxic interference in Russia. The fact that it surrounded Russia with missiles, with the expansion of NATO eastwards, even though there was a very clear agreement between the Reagan and later the first Bush administration with Gorbachev first and Yeltsin later, that there would be no expansion to the east. In a sense, Putin is a monster that the West created through expansion of NATO, through aggressive strategies towards Russia. When Putin himself was initially president, you will recall that he actually suggested to the West that Russia should become a member of NATO. And it was clear from, this is what my friends in the United States have said, people who were in the government, or people like George W. Bush, you know, colleagues and people that I've known and I've spoken to many years ago, they said to me, look, our strategy in Europe was very clear. We wanted to keep Europe divided. We wanted to keep Germany down, and we wanted to keep Russia out. So there is a strategy in place since 1991 that has created this antagonism between Russia and the West, and whose fruits now, toxic fruits, poison fruits, are being experienced by the people of Ukraine.
How is Russia's invasion of Ukraine shaping China's plans for Taiwan? Beijing appears quite unnerved by both the strength of the West's condemnation of Moscow and by Russia's military struggles in Ukraine.
Well, there's no doubt that Beijing is watching very closely the developments in the battlefields of Ukraine. They are watching very closely the kind of sanctions that are being applied by the West against Mr. Putin and his regime. There is a presumption in the West that China was going to invade Taiwan. I don't believe China was going to invade Taiwan. So I don't think that what is going on in Ukraine is pertinent to the probability that China is going to invade Taiwan. China does not want to state that it will not invade Taiwan. It wants to retain the right to say that it might invade Taiwan, but I don't think they have any serious plans to invade Taiwan. The interesting question is what effect is this regime of sanctions, especially the cutting off of the Central Bank of Russia from the international dollarized payment system, what effect that has on the digital one, the digital currency issued by the central bank, and its capacity to pose a significant threat to the dominance of the dollar. That is far more interesting to me.
Mm-hmm. Well, as you mentioned, the US dollar, do you think the American administration is going to live to regret cutting off the Central Bank of Russia from the dollar payment system? Do you think that the dollar reserve is being placed under extreme pressure?
Well, we have to wait and see. I think that, yes, the digital currency of the Central Bank of China is, as we speak, the greatest threat to the dominance of the dollar. It was always going to be, because not just because it is an alternative to the dollar, but because the Chinese Central Bank is allowing everyone in China, including foreigners, including you, to have a digital wallet. Like you would have with Bitcoin, a digital wallet, you can now have, or very soon you will be able to have, everybody will be able to have, a digital wallet containing digital currency coming from the Central Bank of China. That was always going to be a major threat to the dollar and to the euro. The Federal Reserve understand that. The European Central Bank understand that. They would like to create a digital euro and a digital dollar to compete with a digital one. But they have the problem, what do they do with the commercial banks in Europe and America and the United States that insist on a monopolistic relationship between themselves and their central bank, something that China doesn't have to worry about. So Ukraine comes into this existing competition between Washington, Frankfurt and Beijing, and tilts the scales in the direction of a digital one. It's not just a question of the one replacing the dollar. I don't think that's going to happen anytime soon. But you're going to have an increasing section of the world that is going to be served by the digital one. So there's going to be fragmentation. You're going to have hemispheric division. The Western Hemisphere will have its own payment system, and then the rest of the world may have its own payment system based on the digital one. Now, that is a real threat to globalization. And yes, I think that the American administrations in the future are going to look back to the cutting off of the Central Bank of Russia from the dollar system as something of a mistake.
Now, Mr. Varoufakis, let's talk about sanctions for a while. When sanctions are slapped on a dictatorial regime, they hurt the people, not the dictators. We have seen Saddam Hussein survive sanctions. We have seen Kim Jong-un and his predecessors survive sanctions. We have seen numerous Iranian governments since 1979 survive sanctions. So if Putin has a very large war chest, and we know that he does, and if he doesn't care about the plight of the Russian people, how will sanctions hurt him?
They won't. Sanctions are hurting the Russian people, at least in the short to medium term. The Russian regime is not going to be affected at all. I was only yesterday looking at the balance of payments figures that came out of Moscow, of the Central Bank of Russia. Russia has never experienced such a large balance of payments surplus. And the reason, of course, is simple. They continue to sell gas and oil internationally, including to the Europeans. The price is going up because of the uncertainty. So they're raking in more dollars and more euros from the given quantities that they are selling to Europe and to the rest of the world. While at the same time, the sanctions are shrinking the goods that are being imported into Russia. So the balance of payments is becoming exceptionally surplus driven. And that is results, of course, in the revaluation of the ruble. You can see that the ruble now is where it was before the war.
Yeah.
So, you know, Putin is not being put under a lot of pressure.
Right.
No, you know, normal Russians are, not Putin.
But do you see the possibility of Vladimir Putin reorienting his economy towards China? You know, there's been a lot of talk about Russia increasing its gas exports to China. And in the long term, some analysts have claimed that Russia might become risked becoming a vassal state of China. Is that too far-fetched for you?
It is both far-fetched and realistic. It is realistic in the sense that the Chinese economy is massively larger than the Russian economy. It's 10 to 1, that's the ratio. So it is never going to be a relationship between equals when it comes to economics. But then again, Russia has superiority when it comes to nuclear weapons, to certain technologies like space technologies, like fertilizers and the technologies around fertilizers. So that would ameliorate for the imbalance between Russia and China. But my fear as an internationalist is that these developments are creating greater geopolitical tensions, and you never know how these tensions are going to yield and what kind of crisis they're going to yield. And the fragmentation seems to be between the global north and the global south, because even though the United States and Europe have managed to sway many countries around the world to support their position against Russia, and of course, because, you know, let's face it, Ukraine was invaded. There was no reason why Putin should have invaded the Ukraine. So there is a moral argument against Putin here internationally. But if you look at the actual sanctions and the actual economic choices of countries around the world, you'll see that if you exclude Europe and the United States and maybe Canada and Australia, the rest of the world, the global south, is not siding with the West. And increasingly, they are drawn closer to China and through China to Russia.
Now, ever since Russia began its offensive against Ukraine, many politicians and economists, including Bill Browder, who is still the most vocal, have been calling for oligarchs supporting the Kremlin to be sanctioned. Now, a lot of these oligarchs are based in London, which makes it seem as if the UK has a kleptocracy problem. Why would the Russian oligarch choose to stash his money in a Western liberal democracy and not in Moscow?
Oh, it's really very simple. Because Western liberal democracies were always constructed as safe havens for oligarchs. The whole point of liberalism, and in particular, English liberalism and the English liberal judicial system, is to allow those with huge quantities of money to keep them in a country like England without the state even knowing that they have the money there. So if you're an oligarch, or a Russian oligarch, and you keep your money in Russia, you know Putin is going to know what, how much money you have, where you have it, and Putin can actually grab it from you. But in Britain, you know, all sorts of oligarchs, it's not just Russian oligarchs, right? It's American oligarchs. It is South American oligarchs.
Gulf princes as well.
Gulf princes, Nigerians, Saudi Arabians, Greeks, they all descend upon London because that's where they can hide their money. Let's face it, the city of London and the whole jurisdiction of England, I'm an Anglophile, it's my second home in a sense, but nevertheless, I have to say that. I would say this even if I were English. England is the greatest safe haven for oligarchs.
You know what's interesting? Russia's wealthiest have taken about half of their wealth, nearly $200 billion, out of the country. At the same time, America's wealthiest have taken out around $1.2 trillion U.S. dollars out of the country, principally to avoid paying taxes. So why is oligarchy considered an exclusively Russian phenomenon?
Because, you know, the Russians are the enemies of the West. So they are going to be painted in the worst possible colors. Whereas, you know, our oligarchs, in inverted commas, our oligarchs, are completely out of the picture. So, you know, this is why I wrote an editorial article couple of weeks ago suggesting that, yeah, actually I welcome the spotlight being put on Russian oligarchs if it is the first step towards expropriating the ill-gotten fortunes of all oligarchs, including the Westerners.
Right. Now, in the coming months and years, who are going to be the winners and who are going to be the losers of this new world order, if you will? Some people
everybody.
Will be making a lot of money. The fracking industry in the U.S. will be making a lot of money, definitely.
Sure. Look, everybody's going to lose. All the majorities, a majority of people in every country is going to lose out, is already losing out. The people who find it difficult to put food on the table in England, in Germany, in France, in Greece, of course, in Latin America, in Africa, in Asia, with increasing inflation, increasing energy prices, you know, they are going, all of the majority of the human species is already worse off. But there are very few, the 1% of the 1% who are making a mint. Because if you're selling fracked oil, as you said, from New Mexico or Missouri or Minnesota or from Texas to Europeans, you're selling it at three times what you used to sell it. And if you're making nuclear weapons, anti-aircraft missiles, all sorts of armaments, you are laughing all the way to the bank. The 1% of the 1% are doing incredibly well at the expense of the majority of people in every country. And let's not forget, at the expense of the human race as a whole, to the extent that we are delaying massively the green transition at the time of a climate emergency, when we should be investing as a species at least 10% of our global national, our global income, our global GDP, we should be investing it in making the transition away from fossil fuels. And now what you have is a renaissance of the fossil fuel industry. Right. So, you know, if you look at Earth from the perspective of an extraterrestrial, hypothetically, we look like a very stupid species.
Right. Mr. Yannis Varoufakis, it was a pleasure speaking to you. Thank you so much for your time.